So today we are going to discuss in detail the control of genes and the control of biochemical activities of the cell. In the last lecture, we discussed how the formation of proteins is controlled by the genes present in the DNA. In this lecture today, we are going to discuss how the proteins are going to control the genes and how the other enzymatic or the chemical biochemical activities of the cells are controlled. We previously discussed that proteins are basically formed by a signal coming from the DNA. Normally, DNA is present in a helical form. RNA polymerase, an enzyme, comes and attaches to the DNA, and it codes a portion of the DNA in the form of RNA, which is known as messenger RNA. Messenger RNA comes out of the nucleus, and inside the nucleus, it gets attached to the ribosomes. And when it gets attached to the ribosomes, another RNA, known as transfer RNA, brings amino acids, and the sequence by which the messenger RNA has been coded, the amino acids get attached in that sequence, and a specific protein is formed. So this was discussed in detail, how there are codons, how there are anticodons, how the codon and anticodon attaches, how there are different types of transfer RNAs, and each transfer RNA basically having a different anticodon, and each transfer RNA also is having a specific amino acids, and how the amino acids gets attached to one another, and how they are forming the different types of proteins. Today we are just going to discuss how the proteins that has been formed by a message coming from the DNA, how this protein is going to affect the gene which has been coding for these proteins. So the master chef messenger RNA polymerase, basically sitting in a specific portion of DNA, writes a specific recipe in the form of messenger RNA. This recipe is decoded by different students of this master chef in the cytoplasm and makes different dishes in the forms of proteins. So this was discussed previously. Today we are going to discuss the opposite way. So inside the DNA there is a small portion of known as gene. For example, this small portion, it is having 1, 2, 3, or 4 sets of genes which are coding for a specific type of protein. So we have enlarged this portion of the DNA here. This portion of the DNA has been enlarged here. This portion of the DNA contains 3 genes: gene 1, gene 2, gene 3. The three sets of genes, they are basically coding for different types of enzymes, and the enzymes coded by these three genes are enzyme number 1, enzyme number 2, and enzyme number 3. The genes present in this DNA, which we have enlarged here, are basically attached to each other or are present in a specific sequence with each other. And this sequence of genes in which they are present in the DNA is known as operon. This is known as operon. But in front of the genes, there is a small area known as the promoter region. Before the gene 1, 2, and 3, there is a small area known as promoter region. This promoter region is very important because this is the site for the binding of RNA polymerase. The master chef which is going to code recipes for different proteins is basically coming and attaching to this promoter region, and from here it will open the DNA and it will code the messenger RNA, which we have discussed in detail in the last lecture. So this is the promoter region, is basically the site where RNA polymerase get attached. Now we have seen that once RNA polymerase get attached to this area, it opens the DNA and it codes messenger RNA. The messenger RNA goes to the cytoplasm, a protein is formed. Now what happens once the protein has been formed? The proteins that has been formed, this red color protein, they are normally the enzymes. And the enzymes normally helps in functioning of the chemical reactions inside the cell. They basically convert different substrates into products. Enzymes are basically responsible for the formation of lipids. They are basically responsible for the formation of glycogen. They are basically responsible for formation of different products. And all the products are basically formed from some pre-existing substrates. The substrates are basically combined in specific combination. Some chemicals are chemical constituents are removed, some are added, and some products are formed. Once the product has been formed, whichever the product may be, it may be a lipid or a glycogen or a purine or a pyrimidine or whatever, these products are having a negative feedback inhibition. They are negatively affecting the gene which are coding for the enzymes, because if the genes which gets activated by the attachment of RNA polymerase, if it is not inhibited, the proteins will form and the human body will grow, or some part of the human body will grow and it will be uninhibited. Of course, these things happens when the genes get mutated, but normally it's not the phenomenon. So the products, the end products, the genes are coding for the enzymes. We are just considering enzymes, it may be something else. But these genes are coding for the proteins. The proteins here acts as enzymes. They help in the formation of products. And the products, once they are formed, they are controlling. They are negatively controlling the genes. Sometimes they may be positively controlling the genes. If the amount of product is decreased, then they may be positively controlling the gene. For example, there is deficiency of the products, then they will activate the gene. Once the protein products are in large amount, then they will inhibit the genes. But how the products are activating the gene, how they are inhibiting the genes? So let's discuss the promoter region. This promoter region is the site where we discussed that RNA poly. It is basically attaching to this site. Once the products are formed in large amount, these products will come and attach to a site known as repressor operator. The repressor operator is a specific site. If it gets activated, it will inhibit or it will not allow the attachment of RNA polymerase to the promoter region. If the products are in large amount, then it will activate the repressor operator. It will get attached to the repressor operator, and the repressor operator, the protein normally which gets attached to the repressor operator is known as repressor proteins. But if the products are in less amount and we need some products, then it will activate the activator operator. So we see in the promoter region, before the promoter region, we have activator operator. Activator operator is the site which, if protein if some product binds to this area or the protein which is known as the activator, if it binds here, it will help in attachment of RNA polymerase, and anything which helps in attachment of RNA polymerase to DNA, it will open the DNA and it will start formation of messenger RNA, and messenger RNA will go into the cytoplasm and it will start production of the protein. But anything which inhibits the attachment of RNA polymerase, it will stop the opening of the DNA, it will stop formation of the messenger RNA, it will stop formation of the proteins. So we are basically having a promoter region. Before or in front of the promoter region, we are having activator operator, and in the middle of the promoter region, we are having repressor operator. Any protein binding to the activator operator is known as activator protein, and any protein binding to the repressor operator is known as repressor proteins. Activator operator normally, or activator proteins, they normally helps in attachment of RNA polymerase, while the repressor protein or the repressor operator normally inhibits the remove the attachment, or will not allow the attachment of RNA polymerase, and it will slow down the formation of products or enzymes or proteins. This method of controlling the genes, we previously discussed this, genes are controlling the proteins, and now we have seen that how the proteins are controlling the genes. So this method of controlling the chemicals, based biochemical activities, this control of biochemical activities of the cell is known as genetic control. This is basically genetic control of the products. The products formed in the cells are basically being controlled at the level of genes by the products themselves. We also have another system known as enzymatic control. In the enzymatic control, the proteins or the enzymes themselves, they are not acting at the genes. They are not acting on the promoter, activator or repressor. They are just inhibiting the enzymes, and by acting at the first enzyme in a sequence of enzymes, normally we have for any chemical pathway, for example, any pathway formation of lipids, we have steps. Step number 1, step 2, and step 3. For every step, we have some enzymes. Here we have some enzyme. Here we have some enzymes. And here we have some enzymes. Although the enzymes are being coded by the DNA or the genes, but if the products cannot act on the DNA or at the level of genes, then the enzymes, the products that have been formed, they will act at the level of enzymes. This is just one enzyme. It will convert the product 1 into the some pre-existing product into product 1. This product will convert product 1 into product 2, and this enzyme will convert product 2 into product 3. The product 3 or any product we are considering, this is basically the end point. So the product 3 will basically inhibit the first enzyme. This will basically inhibit the first enzyme. Once the first enzyme has been inhibited, it will stop altogether the formation of protein 3. So we see that the enzymes or the proteins that are being coded, they will help in the formation of some products. The products may directly inhibit or activate the genes which are coding for the enzymes, or if they are not inhibiting the genes, if they cannot act at the level of the DNA, then the enzymes, the end products, may basically inhibit the first enzyme, the first enzyme in a sequence, in a cycle. For example, we discussed that this is if the formation of lipids or glycogen or anything. In this cycle, we have some sequence of enzymes or series of enzymes. So the end product basically acts at the level of first enzyme. It can inhibit as well as activate. If the product is in large amount, it will inhibit the first enzyme. If the product is in small amount, it will basically activate the first enzyme. Once it is activated, it will help in the formation of more products. So basically, we have the control of genes and biochemical activities through two methods. One is the genetic control and the other is through enzymatic control. In the genetic control, the end products are basically directly coming and acting at the level of promoter region through activator operator or the repressor operator. And in the enzymatic control, the end products are basically controlling the first enzyme. They are not acting at the DNA, they are acting at the first enzyme. So these are two basic activities. These are basically two ways in which the products are controlling the amount in which they will be present. They are controlling themselves. So it can be a positive feedback or it could be a negative feedback. Now where we have one example, we will discuss it. Apart from that, if we considered the operon, that the genes are present in sets, gene 1, gene 2, gene 3, this is basically known as operon, and a protein will basically be acting at the promoter region, and it will either activate or inhibit an operon. But there are a lot of operons in the DNA. For example, there is one operon, there is another operon, there is another operon, and there is another operon. So the product could be activator, it could be an activator for one operon and it could be an inhibitor for another. There are a lot of operons. So one product could be an activator for one operon and it could be an inhibitor for another operon. So all those sets of operons which are controlled by one product, they are basically known as regulon. They are known as regulon. So regulon are sequence of operons that are basically controlled by one product or one protein. So we are now considering one example and then we will end the lecture. We previously discussed that the DNA is basically made of two types of nucleotides or bases, two types of nitrogenous bases known as purines and pyrimidines. In order to make a DNA, new DNA, we need a lot of purines and a lot of pyrimidines in the human body. So here is one example how the amount of purines and how the amount of pyrimidine is controlled in the human body. A lot of steps are required for the formation of purines, one base, and a lot of steps are required for the formation of one pyrimidine base. The enzymes which normally form the purines, once they form the purine, these purines are going to inhibit all those enzymes which are making purines. So basically they are controlling themselves. But at the same time, they are going to activate all those enzymes which are responsible for the production of the formation of the pyrimidines. Similarly, there are a lot of enzymes which are basically needed for the formation of pyrimidines. Once the pyrimidines has been formed by those nitrogenous bases, these pyrimidines are going to inhibit those enzymes which are forming the pyrimidines. But at the same time, they are going to activate all those enzymes which are going to make the purines. So this is a nice, beautiful balance provided by the nature in the human body, in which they are controlling the amount of each other. Purines are roughly allowing the same amount of pyrimidines. They are allowing the same amount of pyrimidines, and pyrimidines are allowing the same amount of purines to be present. So they get matched in the DNA, and the amounts of both purines and pyrimidines are same. So this is just one example how the end products are going to regulate one another. Purines will inhibit the formation of other purines, but they will activate formation of pyrimidines. But on the other hand, pyrimidines will inhibit their own the formation of other pyrimidines, but they will activate the formation of purines. So that's the end of this lecture. Hope you have enjoyed this lecture. Thanks a lot for watching.